to see this talk on West African Textiles in Manchester. For anyone who hasn't been to the Portico Library before, which I know includes Anne and Margaret, it's their first visit, it was established in 1806 as a subscription library. It's still a subscription library, but we do lots and lots of other things as well. So this area is always free for people to visit 6 days a week. We do lots of events, talks, performances, book launches, things like that. And we rely on our volunteers and donations. So we are a charity. We've got big plans to reunite the whole building one day and get it back to what it was and make it a real resource for the people of Manchester for art and literature. So, and this particular exhibition that we've got on now is about architecture and place and this particular place in the world. And of course, Manchester's place in the world is evidenced by things like our visitor books from the 1830s and the 1850s that show people visiting from every continent every week, including places like Nigeria. And it's also evidenced by the industry that's taken place here throughout the decades and all the people who've now made it home. So I'm really glad to have Anne and Margaret with us today. And they're going to be in conversation with one of our trustees, Dalton-Johnson, who's an artist, educator, works with the Runnymede Trust, lots of schools and pupil referral units, and has a wealth of experience in visual art education as well. And he will tell you about how he met Anne and Margaret, and then they're going to tell you about their work, and hopefully we'll have some questions in the chat. So yeah, thank you very much for coming.
So as James has just said, I'm going to give a very brief introduction by telling our story. So if you're all sitting really comfortably, I will explain how I first met Anne and Margaret. Now, as it happens, I have four chow chow dogs, one of which had had pups. Well, not pups, she only had one. So I'd gone to the vet and she had the one by cesarean section. So you're not really interested in that. But I went to the vet to collect the pup. And I was sat waiting in reception, just anticipating what this pup was going to look like, and getting it home. And then I had the pleasure of striking up a conversation with Anne and Margaret, who were there. Was your dog not? Well, clearly, was it not well? Or
well, she.
Were you picking up medication?
Our dog's always been at the vet. Every month we're at the vet, so.
We did at one time decide to ask if we could bring sleeping bags in the dark.
So, and then, yes, exactly. We struck up a really good conversation and agreed to meet up again, because I thought, what lovely
it
people.
It started off with your Manila.
I'm going to start.
I knew this was going to happen.
Since I'm also Show them.
Yes, they noticed the bangle that I had here, and this was from when I was on an art residency in Bamako, West Africa, and they said, well, we recognise those designs, we know exactly where those designs come from, and I went, well, yeah, really, do you? And as it happens, they did.
We did.
They were able to give...
They were called Manilas, and they were a form of currency at one time, along with the cowrie shell.
And so they put me in my place, and we arranged to meet again. And so I think it was like, was it a week later or something like that?
COVID.
After COVID, was it?
It was before COVID.
Before COVID.
Then you found out that we were still alive.
Yes. And then I visited, and I really wasn't expecting this richness.
There's even more at home.
There's lots more at home, and I just could not believe that it was all hidden away. And I felt quite strongly, partly because of my journey as someone of the African diaspora, and partly because I'm engaged in research and looking at, quite strongly connected with the Black Archive in London and the Race Relations Archive here in Manchester. I feel quite strongly about hidden narratives and rich artifacts and information like this, and rich stories that disappear. Once that person disappears, that's gone, and you can't get it back. and I was looking at all of this and listening to, oh, that's my phone, and listening to Anne and Margaret talking about their experiences having worked in the Manchester textile industry. And I just thought, not wanting to be crude, but when they're gone, this is all gone. So this, you know, the more people hear about their experiences and more importantly, Manchester's local history, the better. It's so important that it's documented and it's saved, and more importantly, that everyone gets to hear, you know, their narratives, their important narratives. I've travelled to Jamaica just to sit down and listen to my grandmother talk for 2 weeks about culture. She's gone now, but the information that she passed on to me lives on, and I've documented and recorded that, and I passed that on to my nieces and nephews. That's how it should be. That's how important it is. But I'm going to step back and let...
I thought you were going on.
Yeah. We haven't known each other that long, would you believe it? We are. All right.
We're Lancastrians, part Cheshire. Thank you, Kevin.
You're welcome.
That's no excuse.
It's how we are. Thank you for giving an introduction, and thank you for asking us to come and speak about what we did, and thank you all for coming to listen to it. Whether by the time I've finished you'll be any the wiser, I'm not sure, but we can answer your questions.
Not because of your brain capacity.
No, nothing to do with that.
It's been such a
complicated story. We've got six different sheets.
It is a very complicated story.
We describe ourselves as Morecambe and Wise and Ken Dodd all rolled into one. Right. It is a brief history of the English wax print trade. On the first direct trading contact with what were the Spice Islands, it was through the Portuguese in 1511. And this wasn't threatened until the formation of both the British and Dutch East India Company in the early 1600s. The Dutch East Indies started in 1602 and ended in 1798. They established a trading station at Batavia on Java, which later became Jakarta. They then began the conquest of the islands, and at the same time removed the Portuguese and the British traders. This Dutch sphere of influence was finally completed in 1830 in what is now known as Indonesia. There were two breaks of Dutch control due to the wars with Napoleon, who at the same time as making his brother Louis King of Holland, that is quite important, and also making someone else installed as a governor in Java. This led to the British East India Company sending a force to take the island back and place as governor Sir Stamford Raffles. The islands were eventually returned to the Dutch in exchange for Malaya to come under British influence. And it was this that brought to Java the men who would eventually be the originators of the European involvement in the batik trade to Africa, particularly the west coast of that continent. I'm going to have to blow my nose. You will excuse me, won't you? Please. The Industrial Revolution brought increasing demand for raw materials and new markets in the 19th century. And just as the British East India Company imported printed calicoes to Britain from India, so too had the Dutch counterpart brought the batik printed cloth to Europe from Java, but with little impact. With the defeat of Napoleon at Waterloo in 1815, what is now Belgium was then part of the Netherlands. And the Catholics disliked the Dutch Calvinists, and in 1830, the Belgians showed their disapproval and rebelled. This led to an independent Belgium in 1831. Unfortunately, Most of the textile industry of both countries was now in the independent Belgium. The Dutch, anxious to establish again their textile industry, set up a print works in Haarlem near Amsterdam in 1834. A French machine originally used to print banknotes called the Perrotine was adapted and installed in the factory to print batiks. It's quite complicated, so much so that sometimes we can't follow it. The Netherlands Trading Company placed orders for printed cloth for Java, where local demand was more than the local hand-done production could cope with. Has anybody been to Java? Anybody been to Indonesia? You have, so you know how it's done. The original batik is painstakingly done. As mentioned previously, along with the Portuguese, the British were forcibly removed from the island, and also both were dismissed from their trading posts in West Africa. This meant the Dutch were now able to trade between their holdings in Africa and the East Indies. The Dutch forts on the coast of Gold Coast, now Ghana, were engaged mostly in the slave trade. Their policy was to recruit local coast Africans, especially from their fort at Elmina, as soldiers to supplement their own troops. As the source of European mercenaries originally became less, Dutch recruitment of the African population was extended to the Gold Coast, Ghana, and in 1833, the first African soldiers arrived in Java. The practice, though, was short-lived, as the Dutch were only too well aware that other European countries would interpret Africans in their army as being a continuation of the slave trade, abolished in 1807. So they resumed in a different form and lasted until the Dutch African forts were handed over to Britain in 1872. Over 3,000 men from, as it was then, I keep saying Gold Coast, but that's what it was, from the Gold Coast, served for 12 years in the Java Wars. And by the time recruitment ceased, an estimated 700 to 800 Africans decided to return home, though many stayed on in Java. Having been recruited originally from Elmina, it was to this port that the Africans returned, staying together to live on and around a hill that eventually became known as Java Hill. And on returning home, legend has it that they dressed in the manner of the Javanese. So what was the fabled Javanese batik cloth? What does the fabled batik cloth have to do with the designs for West Africa that were drawn in studios across Manchester, engraved onto copper rollers at the works in Leventune, and printed at Newton Bank Printworks, Hyde, in Cheshire, and after checking, packing, shipping, arrived in many African destinations? What was the link? Excuse me. It's a bit warm.
Where do I come in? Shriveled with a look.
So what was the link? We have a name, that of Ebenezer Brown Fleming. Born on the 25th of November 1858 at Inverkeithing, Fife, Scotland. His name first appears as a turkey red salesman. Turkey red is obtained from the root of the madder plant in the same way as grinding corn. Turkey red was eventually a colour that was very popular on the coast. We call West Africa the coast in the firm. An international madder race between Holland, France, Turkey, and Central Asia started to supply the increasing world textile market, which was led by Britain. Brown Fleming was an owner of a print works and living in Glasgow, trading as an East India merchant. As a cloth trader, he would have been one of the first to find out that the experts on batik printing was the Dutch firm of Prevenair, based in Haarlem in Holland. When Brown Fleming started to specialise in what we call wax prints for West Africa is not known, but the first prints made by the Dutch company were exported to Africa in 1893 and were successfully received. It must be remembered that batik cloths were not indigenous to West Africa. The style was not the local craft as in Java, and it was also cheaper to print the style in Europe rather than have the expensive hand-drawn batiks from Java. Brown Fleming and the Dutch formed a partnership, as he has become an agent and merchant, selling the Dutch designs on the coast. It is believed he had already traded there, and his contacts would have made the venture more easily manageable. These first shipments were known as the Haarlem range, and Brown Fleming obtained the monopoly of the Dutch production. In essence, he became the middleman. He also saw the potential of the product, so he registered the designs which he ordered in the UK in his name, despite the fact that they'd been supplied to Java by Prebinair and they had been originated with that company. I think there was about 20 altogether. These designs were, to say at the least, to become a contentious item, and in future years, when the Calico Printers Association come into the story. Calico Printers had the offices in that beautiful building on Oxford Street, St. James's Building. They had all of it. Brown Fleming died in 1912. Remember these, that he's using Dutch designs under his own name. Brown Fleming died in 1912, and the First World War caused many problems for the Dutch. So production was reduced, and despite the best efforts of Brown Fleming, his son-in-law, to keep the firm going, it was the Calico Printers Association in Manchester that offered to step in, and in 1935 agreed to print the designs. But due to a boycott of British goods on the Gold Coast, Ghana, Brown Fleming's company was caught with a large stock of cloth on its hands and eventually sold out to the CPA, Calico Printers. And this sale included contentious Dutch designs. I've little knowledge of Ebenezer Brown Fleming, and my contact with the local history department in Glasgow couldn't offer any more. It is, though, his activities with the Dutch that forms the origins of English wax print production, and our involvement, as many others who would have gone before us as designers for West African wax prints. Newton Bank Print Works in Hyde. Hyde's rapid expansion in the 19th century quickly obliterated the pastoral scene that the works first enjoyed. Built in 1812 by two brothers of the Ashton family, they formed a comprehensive manufacturing and finishing business for the enterprising family, passing to various members over the years, and after some successful business, the trade name of F.W. Ashton came into existence, to be taken over in 1899 by the CPA. By then, an amalgamation of 46 textile printers in the northwest of England. The industrial expansion in the comparatively short way for the textile trade, the space of time, exceeded the production, exceeded demand. Healthy competition within sustained the industry was replaced by a scramble for business, and many printers lowered their standards, causing a decline in the textile market. So that's why the Calico Printers came into existence. 49 different groups, all under one umbrella.
Can we come in now?
Yeah.
Do you want to know how we got into
Well, I'm coming to that.
Yeah, I know, but by the time you finish your spiel, I'll have to go home.
Well, I just have to say about CPA, because...
I just want to tell you. How many more bits have you got?
I've just got a bit more, but if you want, you know. The Calico Printers took over what was Brown Fleming's little organisation. So obviously they got all these wax prints, these patty style wax prints. Right, off you go.
Can you talk into the microphone? That would be really helpful.
For me? Or for either. I wondered if your voice was coming.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Are you coming over here then if you want to finish your spiel?
There is a microphone there.
No, I don't know. Where am I? You see these interruptions? People have got the thread.
Let me just lower it for you.
I'm all right. Taken over by CPA. After the First War, Frank Ashton began, he was still in charge of Ashton Works in Hyde, but it didn't belong really to them. Frank Ashton began experimenting with the production of wax prints, by now a growing demand in West Africa, and at one time accounted for 90% of the work's output. During the Depression, the African print trade was the only textile business in England, at least, that thrived. Later in the 30s, a cocoa boycott led to many workless weeks. With the introduction of fitter machines in the printing process in 1934, the CPA became the dominant group in the UK for wax printing. A tightly organised trading structure evolved to market the increased production capacity, and a committee known as the Wax Ring was formed. Other merchants were found not to be acceptable if they weren't in the CPA group or they had their own print works. As these merchants outside the monopoly closed down, their existing stock and designs became the property of the CPA, leaving Newton Bank Printworks in Hyde to be the most successful producer of wax prints, and from 1966 onwards in England. So what about the Dutch, now called Blisco? This firm has over the years become the main company in Holland to print waxes. Unlike their English counterparts, they invested financially in machinery and in design, and obviously it became apparent that Newton Bank failed to compete with the quality of both printing and design. That was now being required by a more discerning customer on the coast. It was no detriment to the English designers of the past, or the ones Margaret and I were part of, that our designs in many ways looked old-fashioned. The Dutch, with their involvement in the East Indies, had what can only be termed a head start. And it wasn't helped by the CPA at that time when they opened a printworks in Ghana. The output from Newton Bank dropped to over half production during the next 2 years. In order to overcome these difficulties, the name of F.W. Ashton was dropped when the Swiss firm A. Brunschweiler took over Printworks and Design Studio sometime in the late 1970s. This firm was already well known in West Africa, meaning new market areas in that place became available. The CPA had also in the 1970s opened up a printworks in what was the Congo, but is now Zaire, which resulted in the almost closure of Newton Bank. But the end of the Nigerian problems, the war in Biafra, caused an unprecedented demand for wax prints in that country, who favoured the colours red and yellow. This takeover by Brunschweiler enabled money to be poured into Newton Bank, a major requirement, as the more sophisticated markets became available to ABC, that was its trade name, especially the former French territories. What used to be termed object and ground were no longer acceptable, and as usual, our product compared very unfavourably to the Dutch. The designs from the studio had to change, and a complete rethink was instituted as to the style of designs and the coloration of them. All of this we hoped would make it possible for the works to survive, as well as the designers, and hopefully to compete with the Dutch. There's a picture in there from the National Geographic magazine many years ago, which catches for me the essence of what was in the West African market called Manchester cloth, and sold in the markets there for roughly 100 years. I worked for two other wax print firms in Manchester, which were A.G. Leventis UK, a Greek firm of textile importers and other goods into Nigeria. They moved to London, but commitments of mine meant I was unable to go with them. Their designs were imitation wax prints that were designed to look exactly like the real thing, but that is another story altogether. Then at Logan & McKelt, importers of textiles and other products. They closed down, so my tenure with them was from 1969 to 1972, when I started work at A. Brunschweiler & Company Limited, until made redundant in 1991. The design studio moved from Manchester out to Newton Bank in 1995, roughly, and eventually closed in the early 2000s. Was taken over by the Char Group, a Chinese company who shipped out the machinery. Shipped out the machinery and the marvellous archive to Ghana to start up to trade on the coast. So that was the finish of it in this country. It lasted, I think, for about 5 or 6 years at Newton Bank after Newton. It lasted about 5 or 6 years at Newton Bank after you finished.
Yeah.
But it's now a dead dodo. It's a dodo. No, nothing like this is now printed in this country at all. It's all done by the Dutch and local production. The archive which I had to sort out was absolutely wonderful. The designs, the books, everything that was there has all gone out to this Char Group now. Nobody can see anything when we are both in an industrial archaeological group, and I told a friend of ours that the works was closing down in there, get in there, because he wanted to record what was left of an industry that was to do with this country. They wouldn't let him in until everything had been stripped out, and then they could go around and measure the brickwork, what was left. So I am a bit emotional about it, because it is something I think that Manchester should look into or have some respect for. All right, there's some shady business in the early 1800s that's gone on that we all can understand, but it may work for us, for thousands of other people, and it made work for people on the coast. And I think it was a wonderful, wonderful job to have taken on, because I knew nothing about it when I first started at Leventis.
But you learn
your craft from the bottom up, and it was just so wonderful to do it. Neither of us have been to Africa, we've not set foot in the continent. And I must tell you this, because there was no offence taken and there was no offence given, but there was a black man that used to come in from the Congo, and his name was John Congola. Big tall chap, wonderful man. And he stood at my desk one day, and he's looking at what I was doing, and he said, "You've been across there." I said, "No, John. You got flat nose and fig lips," and I wasn't offended. And he took it that he knew I wasn't. Wonderful man, not many of them left. Where is he? He's not so bad, Kevin.
I'm here.
That's it. If you want to know anything, we are here to answer your questions, only too pleased to do it. It was a wonderful time, and we both enjoyed it. Thank you for listening.
Some of you have seen the swatches, I just found it out, and you'll notice how proof they are. Really. block printed, trying to do wax printing, but not really knowing how to do it in a technical way. So
that's a block. That's a block.
Yeah, I'll pass that round and you can see how heavy it is. And can you imagine working with it all day, doing that, planting that each time with dye on it, and getting it registered onto the design to make sure that it fit it properly.
So who created the blocks? Like how did the blocks?
Oh, there's a specialist unit that did the carving. They were so skilled, it was just unbelievable. You could have stood there all day and watched them. Just wonderful to see.
If you all remember your William Morris, he started off block printing before he did other kinds of printing. There'd be a table about the length from that end down here. The cloth would be laid on it. The design is that block. It would be cut to the repeat which was needed. There'd be a young chap at the side sometimes
with
a box of dye and a pad across the top of it. He'd make sure that stayed moist. The man doing the block would hold the block, put it on that, do that with it. Press it onto the cloth. What was there, repeated there, and all the way down and across. A wonderful, wonderful thing to watch, which we were fortunate to do.
This is the earliest pattern that we've got. And this was rescued out of the skip. And we'll come amongst it because I don't want to feel it, but it's very fragile. So we've got two of these original wax prints done in Java with the Java style, and this Java style carried into the African prints that we did. Yeah, there's the wing.
That's genuine Javanese, 1909 again.
No,
and
this
that
is
was that object.
Hand painted in Java.
Could be used onto a what would be a modern day wax print.
So were you creating these designs?
Well, those are all there. Yeah.
Those are all our designs that are on the table.
At one time there was Christina was in the studio, all doing wax prints.
Feels different, doesn't it? Yeah.
Did you train in design or did you learn on the job?
I did 2 years at Salford Technical College on the art school and an industrial course. But until I started at AG Leventis, I had no idea, none whatsoever. And in those days, you started at the bottom and you worked your way up. We both started as finishers. There was a studio manager. He'd start a design off, give it to you to finish. As Morecambe and Wise used to say, you can't see the join. He'd do a part of it and we had to finish it off. And in those days, we did what were called imitation waxes. And they used to leave our desks exactly like a piece of cloth, because they were printed in Japan. They weren't done in the ordinary way, they were just put onto a roller, they were engraved onto a roller, and it was just printed. We made it look like a wax print on a piece of paper. And it went out to Japan to be printed and then shipped to Africa.
Yeah, the work that's going this way.
That's an original label. That's as much a treasure as the cloth.
Yes.
Have a look at that on the screen. I hold it here.
And have you had these cloths photographed?
Yes.
Thank you.
Who put the hand up before? You did.
Yes, sir. How did you, like, with the motifs, or with the motifs on the screen, like, sort of the batik they had, the elephants, tigers, things?
Well, we had
people, just to make sure of themselves.
Anyway, it fell through. She'd had her orange, actually.
It would have been Ghana.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Possibly Ghana. And I said, well, I'm not going. I've not been asked, and I'm not going anyway. So I got fixed up with some friends, and we went bird watching on the canal. She comes home from work one night to say, I'm not going.
It's been cancelled.
Cancelled. Oh, I said, what a shame. Anyway, this friend of ours got her fixed up in a flight, so we all went off. There was about seven of us all went off to do bird watching on the canal.
When you guys made it call tours, any calls?
I don't think so. Have you had to deal with that?
No, I know it's a fair amount about this because I have a friend who taught textiles at Harrytown in Marple, and she knew it badly.
Isn't that Dory?
No, Julie Macon. Oh. And she was given a lot of these, so I've had some of these. Ages, not as big as pieces of humour. And then I worked at Salford University, and just long story short, I was using a big hall for an event, got there to set it up, and there was something else having been packed away. And the porters were very helpful, but by the back door, there were all these black bags. I said, well, what's in them? He said, well, they're going in the skip. So I opened them, and they were full of wax fabrics. So I took them home.
Oh, thank you for rescuing them.
So, Margaret's been
there
first
in
the
skip,
haven't you?
Yes, there was so much
having
in skips. It
yeah.
was just criminal, really.
So, is this your uncle?
This is our uncle.
And so,
these are our
uncle. What happened to it?
Well, we were thinking to give it to the witness archive.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Excellent.
I know they've got some big archive, and at the moment, we wouldn't dream that Manchester. From what they're showing,
yeah.
we wouldn't know that what we did here was textiles.
Yeah.
Manchester was textiles.
Yes, absolutely.
We weren't in textiles, we were in engineering. So we were quite disgusted last time.
Last time they went, we decided we'd have to find somewhere else. Because if the witness is named after an industrial engineer, and I think it's a disgrace. There are some things that's in that's all right to look at, but you would never think that Manchester was a textile.
What about the Macclesfield Museum?
They're just here in silk.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've been there. We've been in the museum and we've been
There was a print works just outside Macclesfield at Langley.
Yes.
And
yeah.
they used to do block prints and batteries, brass prints. But where their archives gone, I don't know. Unless it is at
Macclesfield. It's still working on it. Yeah. Denise, the director of Macclesfield, because I've done some work with Macclesfield Museum and I'm a trustee here at Portico. And Denise is a member here at Portico. And even though Macclesfield is silk heritage and it's a silk town, they do have some textiles that's not based on silk. So a conversation could be had.
Well, we were going to go to work on the archives.
I believe they're doing something with the group that we're with, the Art Society. They do
commonly known as NAFAS.
A thing every first Thursday in the month. They've been working on the archive, and apparently they're starting on the pattern books, which is another thing. That's a wonderful thing.
Treasure trove.
So we're thinking that we might join up with them because we are members of the group. So we might join up with them and see the pattern book so we can inquire what's needed then. But at the moment they're just at our house.
In two cases.
In two cases.
This is how we drew the design. This left our desks in blue and white like this. And then, if it was liked by the customer, I don't know, do you want to pass it round? practicalities of it. I work more on the technical side of things, working with the, not so much with the chemists, but more with the printers, because this type of printing has a lot of drawbacks to it, has a lot of do's and don'ts. You can't have a drop of more than 2 inches, you can't have a line of indigo, you can't do this, you can't do that. So all the time we were modifying things. The customer would like it, so you've got it. You've got to keep it as near to that as you could, but at the same time you've got to have the practical side of it. So I was in regular meetings, wasn't I, with the technical team at Newton Bank, and Anne had the archives to sort out. That's why she gets upset about it,
because it's gone somewhere where nobody can use it.
From that design, if it was like by the customer, as I said, we got through the practicalities. It then went to Levensune for engraving.
Whereabouts in Levensune?
Holland Street.
Holland Street.
Holland.
Holland.
Not as important as that.
No, Holland Street. As in the country. Holland
Street. Where is it? Levensune.
It's gone now. It's not.
Yeah.
I don't know about the street, but the
building itself is
all finished when this finished.
Okay.
Yeah.
The buildings get knocked down?
I don't know.
I'm not sure about that. But
I should imagine so, because that's what my sister seems to enjoy doing.
And then we talked about colours and which area it was going to go to, which country in Africa it was going to go to, which tribe it was going to go to, because every tribe had its own likes and dislikes. And so you've got to tailor your design, your colourway, to that particular customer's market, if you like. And some of the ladies who came that worked on the market, the mammies, as they were called, and that isn't a derogatory term, that's what they called themselves. They were big ladies, which meant money. Big ladies that wore 24 yards of cloth wrapped round us and a big head tie, satinised, polished
mercerised cloth, mercerised cloth
tie on the head. It's
called a job.
Absolutely fabulous they looked. And walking through Manchester from Piccadilly Station with a carpet bag full of money.
They did, it's true. They just
and handing out £50 notes as a tip to the people in the shop. We never saw anything like that.
No, it's true what Margaret says. They used to come loaded up with money, and you could tell they did have money. They wore it well. Gold.
They looked fabulous, absolutely fabulous, and really pleasant to talk
to. They were lovely.
Lovely people.
They were lovely.
Yeah. So I went to France a few times, because when we started with the French territories, we had to change our designs. They were more sophisticated, weren't they?
They didn't want designs like this.
They didn't want the traditional motifs anymore. They wanted sophistication, different colourways. This sort of thing.
They didn't want designs like this, the old style, object and ground. That's an eagle and a tortoise on a pebble ground, red and yellow. Do that. We did things like that till they come out of our ears.
Yeah.
And there was a saying, wasn't there? There was so many new designs that weren't exactly object and ground at one time, and they used to come and buy stuff, and Gil Priest, bless his soul, he used to say, "You can have these. You can have so many. You can have so many thousand yards of this." But because we've got so much stock of this, you had to take some of this with you as well. And they
just
did.
Just to get rid of it.
But they did. They enjoyed coming to see Mr. Priest.
The challenge was to use a traditional motif like the staff of kingship, which was used in Ghana. Sorry, I forget. Traditional motif in a different way. So update it, modernise it, put different colours on it. So you start off with that, then you put different colours on, you get four on, you get different yellow and tobacco, or yellow and blue, as they did sometimes. All on indigo, all using indigo to start with. No other colour as base design. But then we got into sepik colours for the backgrounds. They're in this book. In the back there. So you have, well, I'll pass it on this now. You've got two lots. You want to pass it round. Flick through the pages. You'll see the sepik ones and the maroon and blue. So you can imagine the base design now printed in bright green, bright orange, really giving a different zingy effect to the same design. You know, it just livened everything up. And it was exciting to do, wasn't it?
Mm.
It was challenging. We had to learn all the time. But it was so interesting. Those are Dutch ones at the back, and I'm ashamed to say that their fitting is so much better than ours was. Because they'd have money poured into their machinery. And they were also doing screen printing. Thank you. So if you want to come and look at some of these
things. You're welcome
things,
to come and look at everything.
Go and help yourself to
just
look at
flick
some
over,
the
turn the pages over, we'll answer your questions.
Oh.
No.
No, not really. No.